Sleep and Sleep Disorders, Part 3, Diagnosis and Treatment.
Wspominamy o tym, że generalnie
generally, the problems associated with sleep are a completely new discipline, and the first milestone was in the 1950s when the first modern sleep study was conducted. However, dealing with sleep disorders is an even younger field. In a moment I'll show you that the first classification of sleep was done in 1979.
Klasyfikacja zaburzeń snu powstała w 1979 roku. Także
it's difficult then to compare it with other disciplines, as it's the youngest discipline of medicine. Even sleep medicine doesn't exist as a field for many doctors, although there are already countries where sleep medicine is becoming a normal medical specialization. I think this may be surprising. Sleep is common, and problems with sleep are also becoming common. So, why aren't doctors working in the field? It's a difficult and a debatable question, but a start has been made.
Ale jak mówię, pewne początki są zrobione i jak wracając do klasyfikacji...
Returning to classification, we can say that currently we have three classifications of disorders. Let me decode this for you. ICD is the internal classification of diseases, health problems and causes of death. The 10th version of the basic classification we use to determine every disease that we have. These numbers are written into the medical file and to discharges. However, it was not until the 10th version, which appears in the mid-90s, that different types of sleep disorders were listed. So, up until the mid-1990s, the WHO did not consider sleep disorders at all. There were individual illnesses, but sleep disorders didn't have their own number at all. As the pundits might say, as there was no number, there was no problem. Now we have a number. We have an illness, and so we have a problem. DAM-4 is the classification of the American Psychiatric Association. It is, of course, the fourth version and revision, but for nearly 20 years, ever since the third version, it has included a very extensive chapter on sleep disorders. The Americans are the leaders in the field of sleep medicine. They have several associations that deal with sleep, and so it's not surprising that they have such roots in the field of sleep medicine. ICSD is the international classification of sleep disorders, the first version of which was published in 1979. It is an American classification and contains the largest collection of classified disorders. The newest edition appeared in 1997 and is the most complete classification describing most sleep disorders. So first we have the ICD-10, the World Health Organization classification, which is an international and which we use every day. It's extremely simple, but its value is in the fact that it exists at all, because until the mid-90s, sleep disorders weren't included. This is a bit complicated, and I know that classification is always the most boring element of every lecture, but I think that from a historical point of view, it's worth looking at. ICD-10 lists 6 illnesses in the psychiatric chapter. This classification is constructed in such a way that the chapters are divided by letter. F are mental and behavioral disorders, G are diseases of the nervous system. The psychiatric chapter lists 6 disorders, and there are 5 additional illnesses in the neurological section. In the psychiatric chapter, we find insomnia, hypersomnia, circadian rhythm sleep disorder, and 3 so-called parasomnias, sleepwalking disorder, sleep terror disorder, and nightmare disorder. The neurological chapter lists insomnia, hypersomnia, circadian rhythm sleep disorder, and breathing-related sleep disorder. The latter is a very well-known disorder, sleep apnea, or disruption of breathing while asleep, but that's a subject for a separate lecture. However, it's worth remembering, aside from breathing poorly and not getting enough oxygen, it also causes the patient to sleep poorly too. And we also have narcolepsy. It's an extremely interesting disorder known as attacks of REM sleep, wherein the person falls suddenly because of loss of muscle tone and experiences dreams. These may even occur from several to nearly 20 times times a day. Sleep lasts only a short while, after which the person resumes wakeful activity again. However, these attacks are extremely traumatic for the patients. These people, despite the fact that they are normal, physically and mentally healthy, and are able to function normally, withdraw from society because their uncontrolled attacks prevent them from holding a job, and women aren't able to get married or have children. I might just mention that this sleep usually occurs as a result of some sort of stress. Let's say a girl kisses a boy while on a date and suddenly falls asleep. The boy will not ask her out again, most likely out of fear. This disorder is very characteristic, and diagnosing it should pose no problem, as the REM sleep that is induced is easy to determine. However, these patients do not get diagnosed and treated, wrestling for a long time with the condition. Often when they do come in for treatment, it's too late, because they are too old. Because for a 40-year-old woman, it's too late. Or a person dropped out of university, and it's too difficult to make up the lost time. There are methods of treatment, so it is worth diagnosing. This DSM classification is not just six disorders, but nearly a score of various disorders, and it's worth looking at five groups. These are called dysomnias, or disorders of initiating and maintaining sleep. Either there is too little sleep, excessive sleep, when there are attacks of sleep, as in narcolepsy, or when sleep patterns are shifted, and sleep disorders associated with the circadian rhythm. We also have parasomnias, episodic disorders in sleep, such as nightmares, terrors, or sleepwalking. Now let's look at sleep disorders linked to mental disorders. I think it's intuitively obvious that escaped our attention in the previous classification, that when a person feels worse, either physically or mentally, then he or she sleeps worse too. Sleep is really a very sensitive barometer of our physical, emotional, and even social condition. If you have an argument with your wife, or if you're fired from your job, your sleep will suffer. From numerous statistics gathered in our clinic, it's clear that insomnia or sleep disorders that are secondary to mental or physical disorders are dominant. We should also remember that in treating insomnia, if we do not eliminate the causative factor, then we do not stand a chance of being successfully treated. There are two categories. Insomnia is secondary to some other ailment, or physical or mental state. Mental states don't have to mean deep depression or schizophrenia. It's enough to experience normal stress or adaptation disorder, which are common today. Simply watching television, looking out the window is enough to cause stress. All this has an impact on the quality of our sleep, just like our physical condition, in other words, our general state of health. Finally, we have sleep disorders associated with medicines. This has become a dramatic situation in Poland, where, according to some studies, Poles use the most sedatives in the world. The last classification is hard to read. It's the International List of Current Illnesses and Disorders. The fact is that we don't have six disorders or 15, but over 300 disorders associated with sleep. They are described, though our knowledge of them is limited. First off, they are divided into dysomnias and parasomnias, disorders of sleep itself and disorders associated with sleep. We have not only psychiatric and neurological dysomnias, but exogenous disorders as well. Sleep is not just a biological activity, but it's also a learned behavior. We know perfectly well that a whole range of external factors, temperature, noise, a poor partner in bed, all of these are factors that can disturb sleep. If they are maintained systematically, then they can disturb sleep permanently. If we compare endogenous sleep disorders, those associated with our illnesses, with that what is inside our bodies, and the exogenous ones, those from the outside that affect our sleep, then the ratio is 50-50. On the one hand, pain factors, on the other, emotional fears, can disturb our sleep. But just as often our sleep is disturbed because we have a noisy neighbors or an uncomfortable bed. This implies only one thing. Without changing both these fears, we will not be able to successfully treat the patient. As far as the parasomnias are concerned, those illnesses where sleep itself is not disturbed, however strange strange things go on during sleep, then according to the International Classification of Sleep Disorders, we can distinguish one thing. Sleep is not a homogeneous event. We distinguish at least two types of sleep, and they include various phases of falling asleep and waking, and that is how we describe parasomnias. For example, there's a parasomnia associated with REM sleep, which is a totally separate phenomenon. Parasomnia is associated with waking. In other words, a person sound asleep suddenly wakes and begins sleepwalking, or there are night fears and talking in one's sleep. There are disorders in transition between sleep and wakefulness, problems falling asleep, and problems with waking. Parasomnias are very numerous, but when a person falls asleep, he still suffers from the same illnesses that he had in the awake state. He doesn't complain about them because he's asleep, or experiences them differently, but this does not mean that these illnesses don't bother him. It's funny how various branches of medicine begin to become interested in the sleeping person and suddenly discover that he suffers from these diseases. That was the case with apnea. The story began with physiologists, then psychiatrists and psychologists, and finally in the 1980s, a syndrome of breathing-related disorders was discovered. It's an illness where the person functions normally during the day, but upon falling asleep at night, he begins to suffocate. When first observed, a pulmonary doctor was shocked that at night a person could fight for breath as if he were about to die. It turns out that a person at night may not only fight for death, but may also have heartbeat arrhythmias, may have altered peristalsis of the digestive system, and a whole range of other ailments. We just need to look closely and evaluate what we see. These are all parasomnias. And we have sleep disorders related to other illnesses, disorders secondary to physical, mental, and somatic disorders. As far as classification of sleep is concerned, this division seems most logical to me. That is, associated with the genesis and causes of the illnesses, their etiology and pathogenesis. We have endogenous sleep disorders, those dependent on factors inside our bodies. We have general illnesses associated with insomnia, hypersomnia, with breathing problems, obstructive sleep apnea, and central sleep apnea. That is, when breathing disorders are associated with a disruption of the airflow through the airways or changes in the area of the brain that stimulates breathing. We have periodic movements of the limbs. I mentioned earlier that currently we have a lot of literature and data on the fact that people sleep poorly because they are bothered by excessive limb movements and excessive anxiety. We have these exogenous disorders. There are quite a few, and they are extremely varied. Improper sleep hygiene is an environmental factor. The syndrome of exogenous sleep deficiency is a very important issue. It's an illness where the person sleeps poorly because he sleeps a very short time. He doesn't have time to sleep. He goes to bed too late and gets up too early, and it functions as a habit. That's exogenous sleep deficiency. Afterwards, for example, when he retires and no longer has to get up and make breakfast for the kids, who've long left home, and he would like to sleep the full 8 to 9 hours, he simply cannot, and continues to sleep his 3-4 hours like he's done all his life. This is not insomnia, it's a state brought on by improper behavior, improper habits. As far as dysomnias are concerned, it's worth remembering that they can also be both endogenous and exogenous, which may mean that our biological clock may naturally be set differently. In simple terms, we may be super night owls, or in other words, have a syndrome of retarded sleep phases, and prefer to go to sleep at 2, 3, 4 in the morning and sleep until 11 or 12. Problems occur when these people have to go to work or to school. I also have such patients. It's estimated that 10% of patients who see a doctor for sleep disorders, i.e. complaining of insomnia or hypersomnia, are patients whose sleep is fine, but their rhythms are shifted. Not long ago, I had a girl who attended a top high school in a different town and had lessons at 7:30 a.m. Normally, she slept until 7:30 or 8, and now suddenly she had to get up at 5. She found herself in a dramatic situation. After 6 months, she was no longer able to study normally. She couldn't even function normally. She's constantly tired, sleeps during the day, and in the end wasn't able to get up to go to school, not because of insomnia or hypersomnia, but because she was falling asleep during lessons as a result of a regularly disrupted, even violated, circadian rhythm. So there's also the syndrome of early phase sleep, a super early bird. This is also a situation that may be difficult from the standpoint of work. We know already that early birds are much worse at adapting to shift work than our night owls. Generally, early birds live well, because the world is generally geared for early birds. School starts at 8, work at 7. A proper night owl barely has one eye open at 7, and getting up takes longer, but can compensate by sleeping later on the weekends. However, early birds have a difficult time when they have to work at night. Very quickly, disorders in sleep and in function appear. We also have cycles of sleep and wakefulness that are contrary to the astronomical day-night cycle. I said earlier that if we put a person in a cave or some sort of bunker cut off from light, then his day will be longer than 24 hours. There are people like this. I have a number of patients who live according to their own internal clock, independent of what the night dictates. This disorder occurs very often in blind people who do not possess this synchronizer, and it's a condition that's totally ignored by the medical community. However, according to research studies I've read, it appears that half or at least one-third of blind patients suffer from circadian rhythm disorders that gradually shift their daily rhythm. Such people may complain of insomnia, will want to sleep at night, but not be able to, or of hypersomnia when everyone at home is awake, while they can't keep their eyes open, because exactly at that moment, every 2 or 3 weeks, it's their biological night. It's also worth remembering about these exogenous disorders of rhythms of sleep and wakefulness, which I guess are a plague of the 20th and 21st centuries, when our civilized life, our social life, forces us to violate this rhythm. Of the disorders described, there's the famous jet lag of people who change time zones frequently. Their bodies simply cannot adapt and don't know when it's day and when it's night. The internal clock is completely upset. And of course, there's shift work, which is very seriously disrupted the rhythm of sleep and wakefulness, and in effect, sleep itself. Among these parasomnias, we also have those associated with specific elements of sleep, for example, waking. We have a body that should continue to sleep blissfully, suddenly one part rouses and awakes.
W śpiącym organizmie, który normalnie powinien spać po Bożemu, nagle wzbudza się jakaś część.
Or the area of movement. Then we have sleepwalking. A person gets up, moves and begins to walk around. Paradoxically, sleepwalking occurs in the deepest stage of sleep, when it's difficult to wake a normal person. And if we do, they are unconscious. The sleepwalker, however, gets up, walks around, does various things, arranges their shoes, cooks meals, etc. It's an illness associated with stimulation of the nerve centers that control movement. Night terrors are a variation that also occurs during deep, slow-wave sleep. The person suddenly wakes, screams, and shows certain symptoms of terror. Both these illnesses, sleepwalking and night terrors, are very common in children and are associated with maturation, as if all these brain structures have to work together harmoniously in order to sleep, but they do not, and something breaks free. If it's a fear that breaks free at night, the child screams because he is afraid. A few moments later, he lies down again and remembers nothing in the morning. And so it is also an illness that is bothersome to caregivers and mothers, terrified themselves that something bad is happening to their child because it is suddenly screaming in the night. The behavior of caregivers can be bizarre. They wake the child up, try to make him drink some juice, or pour water on his head. The child is, of course, even more frightened. I always tell such a mother that if someone woke her up in the middle of the night, stuck her head under the tap, or tried to force something down her throat, she'd be terrified too. The best thing is to do nothing. Let the child calm down and go back to sleep, and in the morning, he will not remember a thing. However, the situation must be examined, and the reasons for the night terrors investigated. Many possible reasons. Conflicts in preschool or school, high temperature in the room, even such simple things may evoke night terrors. There's dream paralysis, for example, a prosaic illness when we are woken suddenly by a nightmare. The brain is active, but muscle tone has not yet returned, and we feel that we cannot move our arms or our legs. I think everyone has had the experience of trying to run away from someone, of trying to move, but of being unable to move our arms or legs. And that's the physiology of sleep.
To jest pełna fizjologia. Tak po prostu ze snem jest. No koszmary nocne.
Nightmares are fears that seize us not in deep sleep, but in REM sleep, when they take on a shape and an image, a dream. Then we fear something definite, falling through a chasm, or that someone is choking us. This is also a type of night terror, but with a completely different character, because it appears in a different type of sleep.
Generalnie stan lęku, tyle tylko, że mający inny zupełnie charakter, bo w innym rodzaju snów nas dopadł.
Disorders with erections during sleep or painful erections are interesting in that it's clear they occur spontaneously during REM sleep. In some countries, this is used as a diagnostic method. If the patient has problems with impotency, has difficulty maintaining erections in sexual situations, he's then examined during sleep. If during sleep he has normal spontaneous erections, that means that his problem is mainly psychological, that something is blocking him. However, if he has problems with erections during waking hours and does not have them during REM sleep, then it's a biological, hormonal, or vascular problem. It's really one of the best diagnostic methods.
Na marginesie snu jedna z takich bardzo dobrych metod diagnostycznych.
Not all parasomnias are well recognized, and their risks are varied. We have, for example, sudden infant death syndrome, a very well-known disorder. It seems to me to be linked to some breathing disorders, perhaps with an immature nerve center which controls breathing and which doesn't always manage the stimulation process. There's also the sudden unexpected death syndrome, mainly in the Far East. We also have such elementary conditions such as bruxism or grinding of teeth, or primitive snoring. Here among the parasomnias we have various illnesses, serious and not so serious. It's a group that is constantly growing. The more disciplines of medicine that begin studying the sleeping patient, the more disorders are discovered. Translated and narrated by Roger Domogalski.